Good morning, Radiant City. All right. Well, this morning I get the privilege not only of being a leader during our time of gathered worship, but I've also been given the privilege of opening God's word to our church family this morning. In case I haven't gotten the privilege of meeting you personally yet, my name is William, and I serve as one of the pastors here at Radiant. I'm not a huge sports fan. My wife's probably rolling her eyes because that's an understatement. I don't do a ton with sports, but even I know that the Atlanta Braves recently experienced a huge victory as they won the World Series against the Houston Astros, right? I think that Pastor Cameron even maybe got to go to one of those World Series games. Is that right, Cam? Yeah. And so what made that win even sweeter was the duration of time that it had been since the Braves had won a World Series in the past, way back in 1995. I was in middle school at that point. In other words, any victory is worth celebrating, but in the face of many years of losses, the glory of the win shines that much brighter. Or you could look at last Saturday's football game between The Ohio State University and it's so hard to get this word out, Michigan, because I lived in Columbus, Ohio for 10 years, and man, that's just a place that we don't usually talk about. And so that Thanksgiving weekend game had been a rivalry for years, and usually Ohio State wins. But Michigan's win that Saturday ended their 8-game losing streak against Ohio State. Their victory was sweet, if you would choose to root for Michigan for some reason. But against the backdrop of all of their years of losses, it made that win that much sweeter. Does that make sense? Right? So in the story that we're going to be looking at today, the story of Zechariah, we're going to see that very same principle at play. His song of faith really is a beautiful articulation of trust in the Lord and in his promises, but it's that much more sweet and more glorious against the backdrop of his faithlessness in the very beginning of the chapter. Our big idea this morning, if you take notes, is this: a song of faith comes from a heart that believes. At first, we're going to see Zechariah's slip of faith in Luke 1:5 through 23, and then later we're going to see his song of faith in Luke 1:57 through 79. So let's go ahead and jump into the text. We're in the book of Luke this morning. It's one of the Gospels at the very beginning of the New Testament. Luke was written by a doctor. And so I want to encourage you to pull it up on your Bible, or if you do it on your phone. We'll have it on the screens, but there is something really valuable about you tracking along personally and underlining, highlighting whatever it is that will help you to absorb it into your heart. So let's look together at Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 5. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord, but they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in years. Well, this paragraph, it introduces our main character for today. His name is Zechariah, and he's a priest, a religious guy. He's a descendant of Moses' brother Aaron, and thus he's also a descendant of the Levites. This was a special tribe of priests for all of Israel. Not only was Zechariah a part of this elite group, but also he married a gal named Elizabeth, and we're told that she was from the daughters of Aaron as well, so they both have religious genes. Not only that, but they are also both described as being righteous. He and his wife were both righteous before God, is what the text says. God tells us that they walked blamelessly in all of the commandments and the statutes of the Lord. And as we turn through the pages of the Bible, there are very few people who are described that way. The Bible is a raw book, and it describes weakness as much as strength, and there's a whole lot more weakness than strength in the Bible. Any strength that we see is strength in the Lord. But even as righteous as Zechariah and Elizabeth were, they still had sorrow in their hearts because they longed to have children, but they were unable to. We're given clues in this text that this couple had been begging God for years to give them a child, and yet they were barren. In today's culture, some people want to have children, others don't. That could be a whole nother sermon for another time about the way children are a gift from the Lord, but I'll leave that one to Cameron and Cliff. But in the culture of Zechariah's day, it was a sign of divine disfavor to not have a child. There was reproach there when a couple couldn't get pregnant. And it was not only that, but it was social disgrace and it was personal pain. This couple had longed to have a child. They had prayed fervently, and seemingly there had been no response. And my guess is that those prayers had finally ceased because both Zechariah and Elizabeth were both advanced in years. No doubt Elizabeth had already passed menopause, and they likely had resigned themselves to growing old together with no one to pass the inheritance to. I don't know the hidden stories behind the faces that I see in this room this morning, but you very well may be silently resonating with the pain of Zechariah and Elizabeth this morning. Like them, you may have prayed for and longed for a child. Or maybe there's something else that you have longed for and prayed for that was totally outside of your control. Maybe you prayed for years and you reached a point where you finally just stopped asking God. I want you to know that the silence that you feel, it doesn't mean that God has not heard you, that he doesn't love you, or that he isn't walking with you in your pain. We see in this text this morning that God had not forgotten Zechariah and Elizabeth. And he truly was with them, even in the things that felt so dark in their lives. Well, we mentioned that Zechariah was a priest, right? And that sets the table for the first part of our message. If you're taking notes, you could write down point number one, and that is Zechariah's slip of faith. I don't know if that surprises you, but as I walked through the passage, it surprised me. I would have thought with the resume that God has written out about Zechariah, this blameless holy man that he was, that if anyone would show consistent faith and trust in the Lord, it would be Zechariah, right? But I would have been wrong. So let's go ahead and pick up in verse 8. It says here, "Now while he was serving as priest before God, when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and to burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense." So we sort of skipped over this up in verse 5, but we were told there that Zechariah was of the division of Abijah. And we know from 1 Chronicles chapter 24 that there were actually 24 divisions of priests in the priesthood. And each division served twice a year. And when they served, they would serve for a full week. And so Abijah's division was the 8th division. And here we are in one of the two times of the year when Zechariah would leave his home and travel to Jerusalem in order to serve his duty. It like sort of reminds me of someone who's in the National Guard or Reserves who performs duty one weekend per month. This was Zechariah's turn. Every other time that he had traveled to Jerusalem for his duty, he had stood with the crowd of the priests and all the people who gathered during this time while the specially chosen priest went inside the temple to refill the incense. But this time, Zechariah's name was miraculously drawn from the hat. Actually, it was through sacred lots that he was chosen, but you get the idea. Zechariah was selected to be the special priest this time, and this really was a miraculous, remarkable thing. Most priests in their entire lifetime would never have the privilege of serving this role, and if you did get the privilege of doing it, you could never do it again. It was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Some might say that this was just a coincidence, that Zechariah landed on this particular day. But we know that with God, there are not coincidences. There's no accidents, that God sovereignly planned for this precise moment in history. Zechariah probably trembled a bit as he stepped into the holy place of the temple. He knew this would be his very first and his last time doing this, probably looking around, taking it all in. So he walks towards the table of incense that stands right there in front of the curtain that's the restricted access to God's very presence in the Holy of Holies on the other side of the curtain. I picture him like fumbling for the packet of incense in his pocket. And when he looks up, that's when everything went crazy. Look with me at verse 11. It says, "And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard. And your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great before the Lord. And he must not drink wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared." Wow, what just happened here? Can you imagine being in Zechariah's shoes? I'm just here to put the incense on the altar, and an angel appears. He stands right there and he says he has a special message for Zechariah. The angel, we're told later, his name is Gabriel. This is the very same angel that Cameron preached about last week, who came and visited Mary and told her that she would be bearing the Christ child. Can you imagine this? I don't know, in our culture, we think of angels as these like, you know, fluffy and cuddly little creatures that sit on clouds strumming harps, but that's hardly what the Bible describes when we look at angels. They're large and they're fearsome. They're full of power and they radiate light, is what we see in the Word of God. Some divisions of angels have hoofed feet. Some have multiple faces. So Gabriel comes and he speaks firmly but gently to Zechariah, calling him not to shake with fear, which probably is a normal reaction under those circumstances, but rather to hear this message from God. He told him that he and Elizabeth were going to have a son. And actually, even though the rest of the message is glorious, I think that maybe that's all that Zechariah heard that day. Can you imagine what Grandpa Zechariah must have been thinking? God, do you realize how this works? Me and Grandma, we're not even sure how many years we have left on this earth. In case you forgot, we're barren. We can't have kids. It's impossible. And I kind of think that his mind maybe froze in that moment and on that thought. But Gabriel did keep talking. He shared words that would have resonated with Jewish minds of fulfilled prophecy, phrases like joy and gladness that almost always pointed to messianic kingdom, phrases like he must not drink wine or strong drink that would have identified their coming son to be a Nazarite from birth, just like Samuel was or Samson was. And Gabriel had told Zechariah that his promised son would go before the Messiah in the spirit and the power of Elijah. Though there had not been a single lick of prophecy in the last 400 years leading up to this moment, not a word from God, one of the very last things that Israel had heard from God came from the prophet Malachi saying, "Behold, I will send you Elijah, the prophet, before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers." Does that sound familiar? Gabriel was revealing to Zechariah that his son was going to be that foretold forerunner to the Messiah. How would you have responded in that moment? I'm thinking there are probably three categories of people in our room this morning. Some of you are thinking, "Oh, I've got strong faith. My trust in God and his promises is unshakable. I would not really have had any doubts." And then there's probably others of you in the room who would say, "I just don't know. It's easy for me to trust in God and in his promises when things are going well. But when all of my plans are changed, I just don't know how I would respond to God." Gosh, if big-time priest man Zechariah is having a slip in his faith, then I don't have a chance, right? And then finally, there might be some of you today here who are saying, "You know, I can tell you with certainty that I don't have faith in God. I don't know him. I don't know his promises. And really, I'm fine on my own." I want to encourage all three groups of you, no matter where you stand on this, to go ahead and track with me as we look at what Zechariah's slip of faith looked like. There are three ways that I see that he slips in his faith. So if you're taking notes, the very first way is this: a slip of faith in God's providence. And this is in verses 13 and 18. God has actually provided exactly what Zechariah and Elizabeth had prayed for. Remember back in verse 13, the angel says, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John." And yet right after Gabriel finishes speaking, Zechariah says to him, "How shall I know this? For I'm an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." In other words, God has provided, but Zechariah doesn't believe that it's even possible. After all, he's Grandpa Zechariah. Time has proven that they can't have kids, and frankly, that season of life is over now. Does this remind you of any other story in the Bible? An older couple who was promised a son who doubted. Who is it? Sarah and Abraham, right? They even laughed about it. Here in Genesis chapter 17, it says, "Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, 'Shall a child be born to a man who's 100 years old?'" Literally, he was 100. "And shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" So just like Abraham and Sarah, Zechariah doesn't have faith to believe in God's provision. Do you, this morning, do you believe that God can provide what he has promised to you in your life? Or does it just feel too impossible? That's the question that Zechariah was wrestling with. Well, not only does Zechariah slip in his faith regarding God's providence, but secondly, there's a slip of faith in God's promises. This is beginning in verse 14 and in verse 20. You remember that whole dialogue where the angel Gabriel tells Zechariah that his son will be great before the Lord, that he'll be a Nazarite, he'll make ready for the Lord a people prepared. Well, apparently Zechariah didn't believe that God would or could do that. He couldn't do the things that he had promised to do through Zechariah's heir. How do we know that? Well, God reveals Zechariah's heart posture to Gabriel. If you look down in verse 20, Gabriel says to Zechariah, "Because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things take place." It sort of seems, at least to me, like a steep discipline for asking for what seems like a logical question, right? Zechariah is right, isn't he? It seems like his question is valid. He is advanced in years, and frankly, how is his question that much different from the one we looked at last week when Cameron was preaching about Mary? Remember, after Gabriel told Mary that she would be the mother of Jesus, she replied, "How will this be, since I'm a virgin?" Aren't those questions similar? Both of them expressed questioning. But God knows our hearts, and he can see the posture of unbelief in one person versus seeking to understand in another person. Mary's heart of obedience and trust is seen in her final statement that we looked at last week, where she says, "Behold, I'm the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." But God reveals that Zechariah didn't believe God's words. There's a third way that Zechariah slips in his faith. You could write this down: a slip of faith in God's person. This is in verses 18 and 19. Let's look at that together. Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I'm an old man and my wife is well advanced in years." And the angel answered him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news." It's so easy for me to be sarcastic as I look at this passage, as I look back on the narrative. Zechariah is standing in the holy place, having a conversation with an angel, right? The word angel means messenger. He's been in the presence of God, and he's bringing a message for Zechariah. How often do you talk with angels? And yet Zechariah asks, "How will I know this? You're hearing it from an angel?" And that's essentially what Gabriel says. He's like, "I'm Gabriel, an angel. I stand in God's throne room. And he sent me to come to bring you this good news." You would think that that would confirm it, right? But Gabriel, he seems to respond and say to himself, "Since you've chosen unbelief in God's providence, you've chosen unbelief in God's promises, and you've even chosen unbelief in me, God's appointed person, then I'll give you an unshakable sign so that you'll know beyond a shadow of a doubt that this is real, that it's from God." Boom, drop the microphone. Literally, your voice is gone. No talkie for the next 9 to 12 months. This is the sign. You wanted a sign? okay, I'll give you a sign, no talking for the next 9 to 12 months. On the one hand, God's direction and his clear communication, it doesn't seem to get any better than an angel meeting you face to face and describing the coming events in your life, right? But on the other hand, I think it's easy to kind of relate to Grandpa Zechariah. It makes sense what he's saying. It's logical that this can't possibly happen, except that with God, all things are possible. Jesus said that. And Jeremiah puts it this way in Jeremiah 32:17. He says, "Ah, Lord God, it's you who have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you." So before we move on to the more encouraging part of the message this morning, I want you to pause with me for just a moment. Tell me how this is hitting you. If you were in Zechariah's shoes, how would you have responded? Maybe even as we were studying God's word together this morning, God is convicting your heart of a trust issue in your own life, a place where you've heard from God, but you aren't willing to step in faith, or a situation where you want to lean on your own understanding instead of trusting in the Lord with all of your heart. Well, there's good news, even for superstar faithful priest man Zechariah, who slipped in his faith. If that's true for him, then it means that there's grace for us as well, right? And that's good news. I remember in the fall of 2018, God began to reveal to Sam and I that he was going to be shifting our church that we were serving in. There wasn't any shiny church around the corner that I was wanting to go to, but the direction from God was very clear in our hearts. Sam and I found ourselves asking God questions like this. We said, "Surely you don't want us to move away from this church family, do you? Surely you don't want us to pull our kids out of the Christian school that we've come to love, do you, God? You don't want us to move away from this house that we thought was going to be our last house of our lives, God? Do you don't want us to leave our very best friends, God? Really?" I think that we knew the answers to these questions, but we didn't want to trust the uncertain direction that God was calling us into. I'd like to say that after 5 minutes of thinking through this, that we said, "Okay, God, we trust you, we trust your providence, we trust your promises, we trust in your person, Jesus." But we didn't. It was more like 5 months of doubting and wrestling with God. You guys ever been there before? But there's hope, and there's grace for every single one of us. And there was grace for Zechariah. And that's because the story doesn't end with his slip of faith. Zechariah is perhaps better known for his song of faith than anything else in all of the Bible, the great Benedictus, as it's called. So point number two of our message is Zechariah's song of faith. What happened next for Zechariah? Well, to some degree, we can make an argument from silence, pun intended. Zechariah couldn't talk at all, right? And some scholars believe that he couldn't even hear. Verse 62 indicates that the neighbors made signs to Zechariah asking him what the new baby boy should be named. If he could hear, they would have just asked him the question. So he was probably deaf and dumb. I believe that Zechariah had had many months of absolute silence to think about what was taking place, to think back through what Gabriel had said to him, to consider all of the prophecies of the past, the predictions of the coming Messiah and his forerunner, the one who would be like Elijah. My pastor back in Ohio used to talk about the times and seasons in our lives when we are clear-headed and close to God. That often happens when we are fasting. And so for so many months, even against his will, Zechariah fasted from speaking, really probably from communicating in very many senses. We knew it was at least 9 months, right? And it could have been up to 12 months that he was completely silent. Zechariah fasted from speaking, and instead, I'm going to contend that he immersed himself into God's word and into prayer. And the transformation that we find in Zechariah's outlook and in his worship are stunning. It all begins after Elizabeth gives birth to her son. 8 days after he's born, they came to circumcise the child. And apparently it was a party because all the neighbors and relatives were there for it. Seems like an odd party to me, but whatever. They asked Grandma Elizabeth what she wants the baby to be called. Usually they would have asked the dad because that was the role of the father, but under the circumstances, no one was talking to Zechariah, asking him for anything because he couldn't talk. But when Elizabeth gave a very unconventional name, she said, John. Then the neighbors and family come and they asked Zechariah. Since he couldn't talk, he whipped out his cell phone and texted them. No. 2,000 years too early, he would have had to find some papyrus and some sort of ink. And what he wrote down on the papyrus is, his name is John. And that's significant, friends, because usually the name would have been a family name. Often it would have been the father's name. In the months leading up to the birth, Zechariah had clearly instant messaged Elizabeth to communicate that God wanted the boy to be named John. And even that was a step of faith. The father would usually name the child, asserting his responsibility for the child. But here, God named John. God was responsible for this boy's life. And Zechariah had the faith to trust him in this. As soon as Zechariah declared the name that God had assigned, immediately Zechariah was able to speak again. And a flood of praise comes from his lips. Imagine the adoration that was packed up in his heart after months and months of stillness before the Lord, soaking in God's word, praying before him. We're told that he spoke blessing to the Lord, and the result was that this story spread like wildfire through the lips of the neighbors, as you would expect, right? In fact, they asked aloud, "What then will this child be?" And so, in worship, and in direction from the Holy Spirit, Zechariah prophesied and sang his song of worship from a heart of faith now. In fact, those same three ways that Zechariah demonstrated a lack of faith 12 months ago, now he sings to the Lord, reversing every single one of those into declarations of faith. Before Zechariah had a slip of faith in God's providence, now you can write down that he sings a song of faith in God's providence. This is in verses 68 and 69. It says this: "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David." Can you hear the worship that's pouring from his lips? Worship is always a response that we make to who God is or the things that he has done. So can you see that here? It says, blessed be who? The Lord God of Israel. Why? Because he's come to us, he's visited us, he's redeemed his people. What does redemption mean? Well, it just means to set free by paying a price. It means releasing a slave or a prisoner. All people of the earth, whether they know it or not, they are in bondage to sin from the moment that they are born. They're in bondage to sin and death, and we can't even free ourselves from it on our best day. Only Christ can pay the necessary price to purchase our freedom. Psalm 130, verses 7 and 8 declares, "O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem or buy back Israel from all of his iniquities." And then Zechariah sings that God has raised up a horn of salvation. I don't know about you, but that seems like a weird term. But in the Bible, a horn is a symbol of strength. Warren Wiersbe noted that this is a picture of one army helping another to overcome their foes. The first picture that we looked at in terms of redemption was about being set free. But this picture is a guaranteed freedom that cannot be reversed. In Psalm 18, verse 2, David declares, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield, and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold." That's who our Messiah is. He's the horn of our salvation. He's the one who has already guaranteed our victory. Before, Zechariah didn't trust that God would provide the way that he promised. Now he's singing of the God who is providing for his people through the Messiah born out of the house of David. Friends, this morning, if you are sorting through issues of spirituality, seeking to understand what a relationship with God is, this passage right here defines it for you. It makes it very clear. From the moment of your birth, your heart has been at odds with God. In fact, your every word, your thought, your action, has everything that has been contrary to God, it's been adding up in a personal sin account. And there's nothing that you can do about it to offset that. Even just one sin in that sin account separates you from God for eternity. But the scriptures say, but God, who is rich in mercy, that he sent Jesus, his son, to die in your place, to pay the penalty for your sins. Becoming a Christian just simply means receiving that gift, trusting that Jesus is your righteousness. He has redeemed you. He has paid the price to set you free. And Jesus stands in heaven now to guarantee, he's the horn of our salvation, to guarantee the victory for all who call upon his name. If you've not done that yet, I want to urge you, do that today. Come before the Lord, receive the gift that he's holding out to you. Well, you do remember how Zechariah had a slip of faith about the promises of God earlier? He didn't even talk about God's promises. Rather, we're told that he didn't believe God's words. Well, wait till you see this reversal. Now Zechariah is singing a song of faith in God's promises. Look at some of these key phrases here. In verse 70, it says, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies. So the holy prophets are there. And then in verse 72, it says, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his covenant. So these are promises. And then in verse 73, it says, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham. You remember me saying how I suspect that for his 9 to 12 months of silence that he had immersed himself in God's word? Well, this is where I'm driving that from. Zechariah's lips are covered in the promises of God. He probably read from Jeremiah while he couldn't speak, where God promises this, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king. And he probably read from Psalm 105, where David wrote, God remembers his covenant forever, the word that he commanded for 1,000 generations, the covenant that he made with Abraham, his sworn promise to Isaac. And he probably even read from Genesis in God's promise to Abraham, where it says in Genesis 22, I will surely bless you, Abraham, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. I'm guessing that he also discovered prophecies that predicted the arrival of his very own son, like this one here in Malachi chapter 3, where it says, behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. Yeah, and then in Isaiah 40, verse 3, where it says, a voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Can you imagine the joy of realizing your promise-keeping God is actually preparing to fulfill his promises in your day, in your lifetime, and through your own family? Well, this final reversal that we see in Zechariah's song is his shift from not having faith in God's person. In the beginning of the story, Zechariah doubted Gabriel, who is God's messenger. But now, here in the closing lines of his song, Zechariah sings a song of faith in God's person, specifically the person of Jesus Christ. Look at the things that God promises to provide in Jesus. There's a list of them here. Jesus will bring salvation to his people. Jesus will provide forgiveness for their sins. Jesus will reveal God's tender mercy. Jesus will illuminate the darkness of the world with his light. Jesus will reconcile the world to God with his peace. As we wrap up this morning, I have to be honest that I've wrestled with how this text can help us in our moments of great trust and also in our moments of weakness. Because truth be told, just like Zechariah, we may experience seasons when our faith slips, not fails, but our confidence in God slips. But because we serve a God who holds us fast, we can confidently trust that God will help us to develop our trust in him. church, if you are in a season where your faith feels weak this morning, you might not admit it to anybody else, but in your heart, you know this. I want to urge you to do exactly what Zechariah did. Not the part about questioning the angel, that was bad. But I want to urge you to put away, to pull away in stillness with a Bible in your hands. And as you read, notice his promises. Notice his unfailing character. Somehow we see that refixing our eyes on God is the catalyst that heals our faith. And if you're in a season where your faith feels strong, then recite back to God the greatness of what you see in him. And thank Jesus for the miracle of spiritual transformation that he's brought about in your life. And you might even sing to him, just like Zechariah did. And the words that you use might sound something like the hymn writer who expressed it this way. "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him over and over. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust him more." Let's pray together. Father, we are works in progress when it comes to our faith. None of us would have a single mark of faith in our lives if it weren't for the way that your Holy Spirit drew us to yourself, awakening our hearts to our sinfulness and giving us the very remedy that we could never have accomplished on our own, the cross and Jesus' transferred righteousness. Father, I want to pray right now for those who are struggling in their faith this morning. Lord, would you give us grace to trust you more? Would you awaken our hearts with your word and your promises? And Lord, for those who feel confident in their trust of you this morning, would you please light a flame of worship that they might sing to you just as Zechariah did, that they might affirm and repeat again of your great and unfailing mercies? God, we are so grateful for you. We're so thankful. What other God in all of the universe treats his people as you do, with such mercy and grace, coaching our hearts along, growing us in our faith and our trust in you, and following through on every promise that you've made? We love you so much. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.